So setting up a blog to use WordPress really isn't all that difficult. It literally takes less than 10 minutes to set up a website to the point where you can start adding content. And yes, I've timed it. Now it'll take longer before people start visiting because no one's going to visit a site that has no content on it. Anyway, setting up a brand new website does come with a lot of responsibility. Now there's a few things that you need to keep in mind if you want to create a successful website. Now, I'm Michael with Thrive Sanctuary, and today I'm going to go over 7 tips of using WordPress to create a blog that I wish I knew when I first started. Now before we get started, if you can hit the like button, help the channel out. For more videos about WordPress or blogging, hit subscribe if you haven't already. And if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, you can always hit me up on social media, on Twitter or Facebook, or use the contact form on writersanctuary.com's website. Okay, there's a lot of things that can go into a WordPress website that will help it grow over time. I mean, I can talk about WordPress performance for hours on end, but here are some of the tips that probably will make the most impact at the very beginning. Number one is make sure you choose the right theme. Now there's thousands of themes that you can use in WordPress that you can customize, but customization can only take it so far. In fact, there's a lot of themes out there that will actually hurt your speed performance. Some themes just require too much from the web server and it takes too long to load. For instance, a theme that is more minimalist takes far less time to load than something that has a lot of sidebars to it. So it's definitely worth the time to check out some of the themes that are available and find ones that are going to fit your aesthetic. Number two is be mindful of the plugins. Now one of the big things about WordPress and why so many people love using it is because there are thousands upon thousands of plugins that you can add to your site to give it just about any ability you can think of. The problem is that a lot of these plugins will affect your site's performance. The more stuff that has to load on the front end is the more time that it takes for a website to load up. For instance, if you use Smashbloom's Instagram embed, it'll show all of your Instagram pictures on the website, which is kind of cool, that's a bit of an engagement to it, but it also slows down your website. That's because new people that come to your site have to download all those images from a third party. These are images that are not stored on your website, unless they're cached, and at which point they have to pull them from Instagram, so when you add another third party to the mix, it slows the site. So when you start adding plugins, make sure that they're going to be something that either you A, absolutely have to use, or B, something that your audience is really going to appreciate. Because you don't want to add something that's going to hurt your performance if no one uses it. Number three is be wary of AdSense and affiliate marketing. Now one of the easiest ways to monetize a website is by using AdSense, and it kind of varies on how much content you need before Google authorizes you to use it. For instance, Practically Living Green only had 10 articles on it, and Google authorized me to use AdSense inside of, I think it was 10 minutes. I've also heard of people only having one blog post and were able to get on AdSense, so it's pretty easy to get into. The problem is that with AdSense, you need a ton of traffic for it to actually be worthwhile. But since it doesn't take much to copy and paste code, and then it's one of those set and forget type of things, it doesn't really matter. The issue with AdSense, though, is that it slows your website down. And when you use apps like PageSpeed Insights or GTmetrics, it shows how Google really affects the performance of your website. With each code that you add from AdSense, it's that much longer. It's the same thing with affiliate sales. When you go to an affiliate and you copy the code for their banners and put it on your website, that has to call for a third party, someone else, to pull in that information and share it with whoever's visiting. Anytime there is a call for information stored on a third-party server, it's going to affect your performance. I'm not saying that you can't use AdSense or affiliate marketing, in fact, you should. What I'm saying is that you don't want to overload your pages because it will hurt your performance. And speed is vastly important in Google. Not only does Google prefer faster websites and search results, but users will also appreciate the speed because about more than half the people that visit your website are going to leave if it takes longer than 3 seconds to load. Number four is to market your website as best as you can. Now it's true that more than 90% of your traffic is going to come from search engines. You want to get your website link out in front of as many people as possible. This means doing things like sharing your content on social media, doing some guest posts, visiting some forums and linking back to your content, putting links to your articles in email. More people who are aware of your site, the more chances they're going to visit. Case in point, out of all the social media sites I use, YouTube generates the most traffic to my blog, more than Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn combined. That's one of the big reasons why I support everybody having a YouTube channel to boost up their blog. The fifth tip is to make sure your content is the focus of your attention. Now, sure, you want to get ads on there. You want to come up with some good theme customizations and get some color and some graphics. But without content, no one in search engines is going to find you. Your audience has to be your primary focus. What do they want to read? Are they going to get anything out of this? That's why you got to write for search intent. Who's looking for your stuff and why? It doesn't matter if you have the best platform in the world or use the best keywords in the world. If you're not creating content for your audience, they're not going to visit. Number six is to make sure you set up a decent publishing schedule. Now, I've talked about publishing schedules in the past, and that's because they are vastly important. Because I've noticed that when I maintain a certain schedule of pushing out content, my entire site appears higher in Google. That's because Google, much like YouTube, prefers platforms that are constantly updated. You don't want a website that looks like it's been abandoned. And the more frequent you get content out, the better. Besides, sticking to a publishing schedule helps you stay motivated, especially if you're someone who works from home, because then you get that sense of urgency and that you have to create content today, otherwise everything's going to go kaput. It's all about building a sense of self-accountability. And lastly, make sure you get in the habit of checking GT metrics or PageSpeed Insights frequently, because over time there's going to be several things that you're going to add that is going to affect your performance of your website, and you won't know what those things are unless you test it. Now, you don't have to test it every day, but maybe once or twice a month, especially after you add some stuff, would definitely show you any kind of problems that you come across. Perhaps you added an affiliate that is taking way too long to load up a graphic. Maybe you added too many codes from AdSense that has really hurt the performance of your site. Now, personally, I use GT Metrics, and I'll leave a link in the description down below, and it's a great platform to show you all the different things that you need to do, and they also give you tips on how to fix it. But there you go, those are 7 tips that I wish I knew when I first started my website. And as a bonus, you might want to keep an eye on what Google's doing, because Google changes its algorithms so often, you want to make sure your website is up to date. A good way to do that would be to subscribe to somebody like Search Engine Land or Moz.com is another good one. But just make sure that you keep an eye on what Google's doing, because you never know when they're going to change something and where your website will drop 80% of its traffic literally overnight. So what are some of the worst things you've come across while blogging so far? I think one of the most impactful is AdSense and affiliate marketing, because those can really slow down your site if you add too much to it. And if your site's too slow, people bounce off of it, they don't visit, Google sinks your rankings. It's just not worth it. Don't make your website look like a NASCAR racer. If you found the video informative, hit the like button. For more videos about blogging, WordPress, Textbook, or anything else I cover, hit the subscribe button. Don't forget to hit the notification bell. I think it's going to do it for me today. I'll see you on the live stream on Monday.